Yield management is the last topic that we will cover in this chapter. Yield management combines both demand management and capacity management. And the regulation permitted airlines to set their own prices. As a result of this, a new approach to revenue maximization, which is called as yield management, has emerged. In yield management, a comprehensive system that incorporates many of the strategies discussed earlier in this lecture, such as using reservation systems, overbooking, or segmenting demand, are used. And as we talked before, airline seats has a perishable nature. That is, once a flight has departed, the potential revenue from an empty seat is lost forever. As a result of this, offering a discount on fare to fulfill the aircraft is attractive for airlines. However, selling all seats at a discount would preclude the possibility of selling some at full price. Therefore, yield management attempts to allocate the fixed capacity of seats on a flight to match the potential demand in various market segments, such as coach, tourist, or super saver, in the most profitable manner, as you will see later. Although airlines were the first to develop and apply yield management, other capacity-constrained service industries, such as hotels or rental car firms or cruise lines, also are adopting this practice. This figure illustrates the airline pricing policy for a coach seat on a cross-country flight. This shows the economic motivation behind yield management. The upper figure, this figure, illustrates the traditional fixed price relationship between a downward sloping demand curve and quantity sold. That is, it shows the number of seats sold for varying prices. For instance, for this price level, we can sell Q seats. If we set the price to this level, we can sell this amount of seats. And if we have this number of available seats and set the price to P, then that many seats will remain empty. So the total revenue of setting price to P results in P times Q. And as I told, if we set the price to P and sell Q seats, where Q is less than the number of seats available, then we will have two results. One of them is that there will be empty seats. And since we have more seats to sell, these empty seats will result in lost revenue. And second, we will have a consumer surplus, as you see in this triangle. This means that there are many passengers that are willing to spend considerably more for the flight than the fixed price P. For instance, this number of seats can be sold at price which is higher than P, but we cannot sell them from that price. So this results in consumer surplus. The second figure, the bottom figure, shows the same demand curve that we have in the upper figure with different prices for three segmented markets. P1 for full coach, P2 for advanced purchase, and P3 for internet specials. In this case, a small number of passengers, that means Q1 passengers, are willing to pay a premium for full coach because the ticket can be purchased at any time and is fully refundable. That's why we call it as full coach. And advanced purchase tickets must be purchased 14 days in advance and are not refundable. And internet special tickets are non-refundable e-tickets that are available on the airline website whenever the flight is not expected to be fully booked. That means an opportunity to sell excess seats at a discount. For yield management, now the total revenue is the sum of price times quantity for passengers in each segment, as you see on the slide, okay? So we find the total revenue as P1 times Q1 because we sell Q1 seat from price P1 and we sell Q2 minus Q1 seat from price P2 and we sell Q3 minus Q2 seats from price P3. So the total revenue is larger than this revenue that we obtain if we use traditional fixed price policy. And as you see on the chart, the consumer surplus is lower compared to the traditional fixed price case. In this case, we have less number of empty seats, and the result explains why passengers find few empty seats in today's market. Furthermore, consumer surplus has been significantly reduced, yielding higher total revenue for the airlines. And this yield management strategy is most appropriate for service companies that exhibit the following characteristics. The first one is relatively fixed capacity. Service firms with a substantial investment in facilities such as hotels or airlines can be considered as being capacity constrained. Once all the seats on a flight are sold, further demand can be met only by booking passengers on a later flight. So we call these companies as firms that have relatively fixed capacity. And second, the ability to segment markets. For yield management to be attractive, the service company must be able to segment its market into different customer classes. By requiring a Saturday night stay for a discounted fare, airlines can discriminate between a time-sensitive business traveler and a price-sensitive customer. And developing various price-sensitive classes of service is a major marketing challenge for a company using yield management. And in this figure, we see how a resort hotel might segment its market into three customer classes and adjust the allocation of available rooms to each class on the basis of the seasons of the year. And another characteristics of the companies that use yield management is perishable inventory. For capacity constrained service firms, each room or seat is referred to as a unit of inventory to be sold, actually to be rented. As noted for the airlines, revenue from an unsold seat is lost forever, and airlines attempt to minimize this spoiled inventory by encouraging standby passengers. Given this time-perishable nature of an airline seat or a hotel room, airlines or hotels award some passengers by a free frequent flyer ticket on a flight that has at least one empty seat.
Another characteristics of firms that apply yield management is
products sold in advance. Reservation systems are adopted by service companies to sell capacity in advance of use. However, managers are faced with the uncertainty of whether to accept an early reservation at a discount price or to wait and hope to sell the inventory unit to a higher paying customer. In this figure, that you see on the slide, a demand control chart is provided for a hotel on the basis of post booking for a particular day of the week and season of the year. Because of some variation in demand is expected, an acceptable range is drawn around the expected reservations accumulation curve. As you see here, for this case, the acceptable range is defined as minus plus 2 standard deviation. If demand is higher than expected, then budget rate classes are closed and only reservations at standard rates are accepted. If the accumulation of reservations falls below the acceptable range, then reservations for rooms at budget rates are accepted. Okay, the fifth characteristic is fluctuating demand. Using demand forecasting, yield management allows managers to increase utilization during periods of slow demand and to increase revenue during periods of high demand. By controlling the availability of budget rates, managers can maximize total revenue for the constrained service. And yield management is implemented in real time by opening or closing reserved sections, even on an hourly basis if desired. Okay. And the last characteristic is low marginal sales costs and high marginal capacity change costs. The cost of selling an additional unit of inventory must be low, such as the negligible cost of a snack for an airline passenger. The marginal cost of capacity additions is large, however, because of the necessary lumpy facility investment, that is, a hotel addition must be at least an increment of 100 rooms. And we have an example that we will apply yield management. This example is from an airline called Blackjack Airlines. This airline discovered that airplanes on its Los Angeles to Las Vegas route have been flying with more empty seats than usual. And to stimulate the demand, the company decided to offer a special non-refundable 14-day advance purchase gambler's fare for only $49 on one-way based on a round-trip ticket. And the regular full fare coach ticket costs $69 one-way. And the aircraft for this line has a capacity of 95 passengers. And management wants to limit the number of seats that are sold at the discount fare in order to sell full fare tickets to passengers who have not made advance travel plans, like we see in Turkey. And considering recent experience, the demand for full fare tickets appears to have a normal distribution with a mean of 60 and a standard deviation of 50. And as I told, the airline wants to determine the number of seats to be reserved for full fare passengers. Here we can again use critical fractile approach, critical fractile model to determine the number of seats to be reserved for full fare passengers. Here, X corresponds to the seats to be reserved for full fare passengers, and D corresponds to the demand for full fare tickets. And how should we determine the average cost? If we are reserving less seats to full fare than the
demand for full fare,
the lost revenue that corresponds to
this underestimation
can be referred to as underage cost. Therefore, the lost opportunity, that means the difference between the fare 69 and 49, which gives 20, corresponds to underage cost. How should we determine the overage cost? If we are reserving more seats than the demand, then we cannot sell these seats. As a result, the overage cost is $49. And by using the critical fractile approach, the right-hand side of the critical fractile can be calculated as 0.29. And we know that the demand for full fare tickets is normally distributed between 60 and standard deviation 15. So we can use the normal distribution by transforming it to standard normal distribution and calculate the value of X. In order for this, we require the table for the normal distribution that provides the probability for different values of Z. Okay, so we are searching for 0.29. Okay, but this table provides the probabilities for the right tail of the distribution, right? As you see here. However, our probability falls to the left tail. We are searching for this probability, which is 0.29. So if we want to look at the right tail, then we should look at 1 minus 0.29, right? So we should look at 0.71, okay? And this is 0.55. That means that value of 0.55 gives this probability. However, since we are looking at the left tail and we know that this distribution is symmetric, so this corresponds to a z value of minus 0.55, right? And this is the standard normal distribution's value. We should transform it to the value that we look for by multiplying it by sigma and adding mu to this quantity, right? And so we get this probability. The probability of x greater than this value should be less than or equal to 0.29. If it is satisfied, then we should continue to increase the level of x, okay? And for this value, actually we get 52 as the number of full fare seats to be reserved.